Coming up, Jonathan and cameraman Tim visit the Tennessee Aquarium to help raise some baby fish. Welcome to Jonathan Bird's Blue World.
Chattanooga, Tennessee is a growing city that sits along the Tennessee River. Just off the riverbank, the towering glass spires of the Tennessee Aquarium, home to over 12,000 animals, ranging across nearly 800 species.
You may have wondered, where does a big aquarium get all the fish? Well, I mean, it used to be that they go out in the ocean with nets and they had to collect them, but these days, the Tennessee Aquarium is growing their own.
Inside, you'll find one of the largest freshwater exhibits in the world, as well as saltwater exhibits. Reptiles, and even some mammals. But perhaps the most impressive part of this aquarium is the giant Secret Reef exhibit, modeled after the Flower Garden Banks National Marine Sanctuary. This massive tank holds 618,000 gallons of water and a wide variety of marine life, from fish and rays to sharks and sea turtles. Because the fish in the aquarium are always spawning and producing eggs, the biologists here developed a unique way of collecting those eggs from the Secret Reef exhibit and raising them to adulthood so they could be released back into the place where they were born. To show us how this process works, we head to the top of the exhibit to meet Kyle McFeeters, the senior aquarist in charge of the breeding program.
Can you walk me through this process?
Yeah, we have the egg collector in the exhibit right now, which these fish generally broadcast spawn.
Yep.
So sperm and eggs in the water column, when those eggs are fertilized, they float. So this device we've made will skim the surface of the tank to pull those eggs off the top of the water. So the exhibit water leaves the tank pretty much through a surface skimmer right under our feet.
Yep.
So the water's being drawn over here already.
Right.
And then this surface skimming box, it'll collect just a small portion of what is being broadcast into the tank.
Kyle carefully lifts the egg collector so we can check for some newly captured eggs.
Dump that water out of the pipe because that's outside the screen. And then we'll come right towards you.
Cool.
Pretty much what we're looking for is on the screen. When you see anything, like there's some junk, some detritus, when you see like something reflective like that,
yeah,
that's going to be the eggs when they're kind of reflecting the light.
Okay,
there.
Okay, yeah, I see them.
Very small. This isn't a huge collection. This isn't a lot of eggs.
It just looks like a bunch of detritus.
You get a ton of detritus and hopefully some eggs.
I see one egg-looking thing floating about.
So we can drop them in where they go and then look at the fish and the algae and whatnot.
All right, cool. Let's go.
All right.
We make our way to the small tanks that house all of the collected eggs as well as the young fish that have hatched.
You're not just gonna pour them in there?
So we're gonna let them float in there. We're gonna add that little bit of tank water like we were talking about.
Okay, yep.
So bring the salinity up, let those eggs float a little better.
Okay.
And then we're actually gonna transfer them from the surface of the water in there to a clean bucket where we'll do it again.
Okay.
Just to keep as much debris from the Secret Reef out of this tank as we can.
Right. So Kyle, are you making beer?
I am, exactly. Now, this is algae. This is the basic building block of our whole process to grow these fish. So we have to start with the smallest piece of the puzzle, that's the algae. So this particular algae is called Isochrysis algae, and it was chosen for its good nutritional profile. So the algae, it's very sensitive, which you might think, you put a jug of water in the sun, you're gonna grow algae, right? But not good, special, nutritious algae. So the algae that we grow, it's very fragile, so we have to sterilize everything, and we have to filter our air down to a quarter of a micron. So the air going in is very, very clean, and the water itself is sterile to make sure we don't get anything growing in there but isochrysis algae. So it's a very thick nutrient-wise algae. So we're gonna take a dark bottle like this, produce two light bottles, and then what's left, feed to our copepods. So it's an endless cycle. Every day we're taking a dark bottle, making light bottles, and feeding out what's left.
And now, I'm guessing that they're going from light to dark. Is this like, they grow each day?
Correct, yeah. So in about a week, a really light bottle will become a dark bottle. So every day we'll make algae, use some, and then in roughly a week, you know, it's 6 to 9 days, those thin bottles will bloom up into these really dark bottles.
Huh.
They use the algae to feed a tank of copepods, small bug-like crustaceans that become food for the young fish.
So we got some tools of the trade to be able to get some of these copepods to feed to our little fish.
Okay.
So I've got this little sieve that we've made out of a very fine mesh and a cup. So we'll scoop up this gallon container there. If you stick that one just like that.
Okay.
And I'll pour this through your sieve.
Okay.
This way, they're not on a dry screen.
Okay, gotcha.
So we're keeping our copepods happy and healthy. They're getting trapped in there, and the water is just going right through. This sieve, because our fish are a little bigger, this sieve is only getting the adults.
And then what do you do? Because you don't want to dry them out.
Exactly. So we'll get a little water here. We'll give this a little bit of a swirl and do a quick pour. That's 2 gallons of Parvocalanus adults right there.
So now what kind of little baby fish do you have in here?
So these, I'm most certain that those are Bermuda chub. So the, you know, maybe 30-inch gray football looking fish from the Seeker Reef.
Big ones.
That's them. These are almost a month old already.
Wow.
So it takes them a long time to gain any appreciable size. And at this size, they'll happily eat these adult copepods. So we can take this this little bit we just harvested there. We'll just place it gently and slowly in there to not freak out the fish too much. And we'll just pour them on in. Yeah, those are more than 2 months old now.
Oh, look at these guys.
Once these fish are big enough, they can be moved downstairs to an exhibit visible to the public while they continue their growth.
So, Kyle, tell me about these fish. What do we got going here?
In here we have some Atlantic spadefish and a porkfish, and these are fish we raised from eggs we collected from our biggest exhibit, the Seeker Reef. So these are actually fish that spawned in that exhibit, and we collected the eggs and raised them up to this point here, and they're getting ready to move back into the big tank.
So they're going back to their place of birth.
Yeah, go back with their parents.
Now, how long did it take to get them this big?
These fish are about a year old now.
Wow.
We're gonna take them out of this exhibit. This is, we call it our larval culture exhibit, so we can kind of tell that story.
Okay.
But they've outgrown it. So we're gonna take them out of here, move them into this cart, and we're gonna take them up to the Seeker Reef so we can add them into there.
Now, just tell me one thing about protecting these fish, because when these fish, they look big, right? But compared to the fully grown ones, they're not that big.
Correct.
So we gotta keep them from getting eaten.
Yeah, the best way, the biggest thing we're gonna do is, you're gonna do, is actually taking them down deep into the tank where all the reef structure is. If we just let them go at the surface of the water, they'd be easy prey for all those open water fish.
All right.
So we're gonna actually swim down with them and release them amongst the coral structure.
Awesome. So now how are we gonna get them over there? Nice.
So
all right.
We'll scoop them out of there.
Let's do it. Don't worry, you guys. It's all going to be okay. You're going home.
To a better place.
Dude, you're going to a bigger place. You're going to have a new room. Oh, gotcha. And then
over here,
going in a nice bucket. He's like, this isn't better. I don't like this any better.
And then pick out one of the fish. If you try to go for them all, you'll never get any.
Oh,
Come here. Oh.
Dude, this is not easy.
There he is. Oh, you are mine. Nice.
All right, I got one. And then we got to keep him from escaping. And over we go. Over we go. In. Yep. Okay. Nice. I'm going to do one more.
Do it.
And then I'm going to let the professional do the rest, because otherwise we're going to be here all day. I'm doing this for your own good. Here we go.
There we go. Okay. Yep. But you're good. Okay.
Kyle is the fish whisperer.
Get in the net.
Shh, go in the net. Nice. Now, what about that little pork fish that's in there?
He's coming with.
Yeah, oh, the pork fish.
Yeah.
All right. Oh. Oh. He's feisty.
Oh, yeah.
That's a feisty little guy. So now, what are we going to do? We're going to roll this over.
Yes, we're gonna take this cart up to the secret reef, and we're actually gonna give these fish what we call a freshwater dip, which is exactly what it sounds like. We're gonna take them out of the salt water, put them in some fresh water, and that's gonna ensure that anything on them doesn't get transferred to the other exhibit.
That'll kill like parasites?
Exactly.
Why won't it kill them?
Because they are such a large, complex animal compared to a tiny, simple parasite,
yep,
that it can kill the parasites without affecting the fish.
Glad I could be super helpful here. I'm gonna hold my coffee.
Straight down to the yellow bucket.
We should name them.
It's bad luck.
Giving them a smooth ride. Oh, bumps. Bumps, you guys, bumps. There we go.
Perfect.
Kyle has me fill up a bucket from the secret reef to help acclimate the new fish.
Oh. And you can just pour it straight in the cart.
Okay.
It's gonna get them acclimating.
Is it because this water is a different temperature? Different
temperature, pH, those are the main things
right.
that we're concerned with. They should be very similar, but just to make sure it's an easy transition, we'll do this. This is a pretty gentle acclimation for them.
While we wait for the fish to acclimate, we suit up to prepare for their relocation. We move them into the freshwater dip and wait for any potential parasites to die off. The fish can't stay here long and have to be moved back into salt water within a few minutes. Cameraman Tim and I hop into the water while Kyle grabs the first volunteer. Mark Craven, the dive safety officer, is helping us find a nice spot on the bottom of the reef to release the fish, ensuring that they're safe from any hungry sharks looking for a snack. There are plenty of small places for these fish to hide while they continue to grow. Down, we find a well-protected area to let them go. With the first mission being a success, we're ready to bring down the rest of the new residents.
Thank you.
The reef in this exhibit provides lots of small nooks as habitat for fish, just like the real thing. On the way back, we take the scenic route to get a better look at some of these awesome sharks. There are sand tiger sharks, always a favorite in large aquaria because they look so mean, but they're actually really mellow. There are also sandbar sharks, distinguishable by their tall dorsal fin. And with that, these fish have completed their year-long journey and finally returned to the place of their birth. The Tennessee Aquarium is an icon of Chattanooga. Not only is it an impressive facility with a huge number of amazing exhibits, but their biologists have significantly advanced the sustainability of aquariums by developing innovative ways of building their own fish populations without having to take them from the wild. A great conservation effort for the blue world.
Hey you guys, check out that video. It's a really good one. Also, this one's pretty good too. Oh, and don't forget to subscribe.